Hello and welcome. This is Kurt Cobain Remembered, remembering the music of Kurt Cobain and Nirvana. Hope you enjoyed the MTV Unplugged. For the next 2 hours, we will be showing you everything that we have on Nirvana. And believe me, it is everything. This is a special, sure, that we ran about a week after Kurt Cobain had been announced that he'd taken his own life. We ran everything that we had then, which is what we're going to do now that we have. Unedited, untouched, all the videos, all the raw. We're also going to add a couple of things that we didn't run back then. We're going to run a piece that was done from Music Plus, an interview that they had with Kurt Cobain and members of Nirvana. We're also going to show you pieces from The Real Deal, which dealt with depression and suicidal feelings. And if you do have some problems or some feelings that you don't know where to turn, we will be running numbers and the places where you can go and perhaps get some help, or at least someone to talk to if you feel that things are getting you down and it's getting a little heavy. Anyway, enough of that. We're going to remember Kurt Cobain and Nirvana the next 2 hours, so sit down, relax, and enjoy.
You heard Teen Spirit being played everywhere, but when I finally got the record and listened to it myself, and just, you know, heard the great surge of anger and emotion, and I thought, oh no, what?
The death of Kurt Cobain, because I think his death was a great loss to the music industry. I think we lost a great songwriter. He will be missed by our generation.
I think if there was a John Lennon type figure for the so-called Generation X listener, the kids. Young people in their teens and 20s of today, it would be Cobain.
Nirvana put out a record that did nothing, and then the next record was an explosion. It was tremendous, and he was thrown into this thing. And I know me, I don't like my pressures at all, and we're not even a fifth as big as Nirvana is or was, sell as many records. I don't like pressures of having to do this and that and having to spread myself so thin everywhere. So you never know what's going on in that guy's head, you know? He could have been spread thin, hated his life. And you know, everything he ever wanted to achieve, probably in music, he probably did achieve. Or maybe he didn't, you know, didn't want to achieve.
If it wasn't for Kurt, there would probably be no Pearl Jam, Stone Temple Pilots, Soundgarden, or any of that movement, which is, you know, hitting the charts at number one.
Guess that you don't care about it.
The whole underground scene's like coming to light because of like Nirvana success, and like everything's just, it, you know, regular radio stations will play bands like us now. It's like, I mean, 2 years ago, nobody would have, I mean, it wouldn't even have been considered. They would have heard that and they would have just laughed and said, are you kidding?
Music fan, he loves music, and you can, if he wants, he can push a band a bit more into the mainstream by giving them help, and that's really good. It's a really, really honest way of bands kind of getting projected and seen by people, and it's really good.
She's a woman and selfish, I don't know hello.
I think if you listen to like Nirvana,
we love that record.
Great. If you listen to that record, you can see a real feminine. I mean, that record's selling incredibly, and grunge is taking over, and it's a teen revolution, and we're all very excited about it. But I mean, the thing is that it's really feminine. You know, it's very compassionate songwriting, and it's not metal posturing. So it's not even a gender-specific thing.
Hey, wait, hey. great. You know, you see bands like Nirvana coming out and blowing everybody's perceptions of what the music business should be. You know, everybody's like going around wringing their hands, going, everything, it's all screwed up. It's not the way it used to be, and that's how it should be.
The bad things that are going on, you never, like, nothing, none of the good things that are going on in your life go through your head.
Sometimes people's problems are beyond their help, and then the people get lost. They don't know what to do.
I've had a friend who killed himself, and he didn't tell anyone. He didn't talk to anyone. He just, there were no signs, there were no warnings.
I have pain right now over my arm.
And I have it here because it really hurt me to see him go.
People say, oh, you know, it's puberty, or it's just a stage that you're going through, and everybody has bouts of depression. But, you know, sometimes you gotta wonder, is it just that, or am I gonna be like a manic depressive when I grow up?
Are Nirvana still a punk band?
Well, I like biorhythm machines, and I put my hand in one, and it was a pretty punk readout. It cut my hand.
I said, Lord, you are so punk.
Well, no, but I mean, does that term still apply to you guys, though? Or, you know, have you...
So I don't think we've ever been labeled as punk rock in the first place. We just played in the underground circuit. We like punk rock more than any other style of music, so... yeah. Punk
rock. Well, I think everybody was sort of into punk rock before the band really evolved anyway. So it's definitely everyone was sort of bred on the punk thing. Okay, now I'm sure you dislike labels, but then where do you see that your music fits in?
In rock and roll.
Isn't this
pretty wide?
I think, what did they call it before? The sub pop sound.
Oh, the sub pop sound.
That's right.
Yeah.
Grunge.
Seattle.
I can't decide.
Seattle sub pop grunge. Okay, but then, the sub pop thing wouldn't apply anymore, though.
Why not? We're still a label.
You guys are on sub pop.
Wow. So?
We're DGC rock now. We're DGC hardcore.
DGC hardcore.
You found
an MCA in Europe and Canada.
Right.
We're MCA.
We're MCA
punk.
Here too?
We're MCA. Yeah, we are.
Okay, now, again, like, I realize you guys dislike the labels, but, I mean, it's still a case of,
Well, we love DGC.
Music labels are labels the way people label people. People of race, creed, or color, national origin. Brother, we're all here on this floating sphere through space.
Okay, but this is a little bit different, though, because I think to a certain extent, people that are out there want to know because it helps them decide whether they like it or not, right? I mean, yeah, that's not necessarily a category thing, but it's still like...
We all like to say that we're the Black Sabbath molesting the Bay City Rollers, or the Knack, maybe.
Okay, well, that was something else.
No one would like us at all.
That would be something else I wanted to ask you guys about. Now, you mentioned the Knack and the Bay City Rollers. Are there aspects of those bands in your music, and where are they?
Fashion-wise, it's Bay City Rollers all the way.
Yeah.
We don't have any plaid on now, but
you just wait till we go on. There's going to be this inverted plaid cross.
That is.
Just going to be with Ozzy Osbourne with a woody shag cut crucified on it.
Okay, now were you guys fans of those bands? Seriously?
No.
I despised the Bay City Rollers when I was 9. I mean, my sister liked them, but I didn't.
How about the Saturday Night single?
But I like them now. I have all their albums.
You like them now?
Yeah.
Okay, because I guess you guys also talked about how you're a pop band, yet I wonder how many people would really describe you in that way.
Well, a lot of people do, just because the songs are, you know, they may be really heavy, but they have some sort of melody to them. I mean, they're like poppy songs, but we're not like a pop band, you know, but I don't know.
Papa don't preach.
Papa don't preach.
Pop music.
Pop music.
Yeah. Okay, now how do you feel, though, about the crossover into the metal market?
That's fun.
Yeah. Well, maybe we could, few of those kids, they could go from worshiping Satan to being studious and alternative, and some of the alternative people could be like smoking pot on their Camaro hoods of their Camaros.
It'll be a
Camaro
trade-off.
Hoods. It'll be a trade-off, yeah. It'll be joint forces. Unite all potheads and bookworms. Come together.
Okay, now.
That's our rally cry of our revolution.
Get on that soapbox.
Now, one of the things I was reading, though, you were being interviewed in a metal magazine, and one of the members of the band wasn't very happy about that.
Who said that? I didn't do it.
Is that a pubic hair?
I didn't do it.
It's curly and crinky. Oh, I don't know. Where did you get that? Who sent you?
What planet are you? Are we going to be able to get anything out of this interview?
Sure, yeah, we're talking.
This is no front.
Hey man, we ain't front.
We are. Well, I don't know. You know, a lot of heavy metal is, I don't really care for a lot of heavy metal. You know what I mean? A lot of it's just kind of, I mean, to each their own, right?
Okay, but then I guess the fact that you're then appealing to that market, or you're having the fans of those bands come out to see you guys, that doesn't bother you, or that's something you'd like to happen?
Oh, we'd like for that to happen, sure. People could come in and check our band out, and why not?
Well,
it's not like we're a band.
You know, people come and like the music, then that's fine. If they come and think we're a heavy metal band, you know.
I remember one time I went to this show in Olympia, and the Melvins opened for this, like, heavy metal band, and all the punk rockers and stuff, you know, the metal people just gave the Melvins a bunch of pahooey. And then when the metal band came out, the punk rockers who came for the Melvins, they got into the metal band, but it seemed like the metal people kind of freaked out. They were weird. I don't know what it was. Maybe
was
something they ate.
Years ago, too.
Yeah.
Now that Metallica are wearing Misfits t-shirts, I think it's had a big impact on metal.
James Hetfield gave the legions of rockers the okay to like punk rock, so it must be okay now.
I'll tell.
when John Lennon was shot, but it's not the same, man. This is, it's like a part of me, and it's a lot more personal. I'll never forget where I was or what I was doing when I first heard, "Here we are now, entertain us." And I'm sorry that he didn't want to stay with us.
Just in case you just tuned in, you are watching our Kurt Cobain Nirvana special, remembering Kurt and the music of Nirvana. Yes, we're also going to be running in this particular episode of the special some of the real deal pieces. Master T and the gang last Sunday did a special on depression and trying to deal with some of the feelings and emotions that we have in everyday life and how some people can rise above it and some people unfortunately can't. And if you do have some problems, we do have phone numbers running throughout in your area, but there's a national phone number, the Kids Help phone. That's 1-800-668-6868. It's a 24-hour number. You can phone from anywhere in Canada and talk about anything you want, and the people are there to help you, or at least steer you to people in your area who can, or if you just want to chat, whatever you want to do, just give them a call if you're feeling depressed. We're going to continue right now with Nirvana and Kurt Cobain.
Being on a bigger label, are you guys involved? Like, I mean, there must be meetings about marketing and stuff like that. Do you guys have any say about that stuff, or is it just something that you just leave up to the label?
We have final say, but we don't go to the meetings.
Yeah, they're all boring.
You can imagine, it's like going back to school, you know?
Yeah,
we sit that out.
And those fluorescent lights hurt my eyes.
So how have things changed for you guys now, being on a bigger label?
We get to be on much music.
Yeah, yeah. We could have been on much music before if you
really
had enough for the interview.
We're never late now.
We're always on time. We're prompt.
We brought watches.
We have tour managers now. We don't get up at 1 o'clock in the morning. Because last time we were here, we were like just us three, you know, driving around. We get up whenever we wanted. Ooh, man, that's a pretty long drive to Toronto. We better get going. Like, yeah, shut up. And then we're like, show up as if we're ready to go on.
Okay, now you recorded your album with Butch Vig. Now, why did you choose him for the producer?
Because we worked with him before, about a year ago. We attempted to record our album with him. It turned out really well, but
We're in the middle of doing the Sub Pop negotiations, trying to get out of that contract on DGC, so it just seemed like the best thing to do, you know, to work with someone that's familiar with us still.
You've done demos with a few other people though as well, haven't you?
We did the demos, that's what he's talking about.
Yeah, those are the demos. That was, I did an album.
No, but I thought there was other producers you guys had.
We worked with Jack and Dino. That's about it. No, nobody
else. We
talked
to other producers, but we never did any demos with them.
Yeah. So. And was there stuff you'd heard by Butch before you'd worked with him that kind of decided it, or?
Yeah, it sounded really good. There was like Laughing Hyenas and Killdozer, pretty crunchy, meaty stuff. And we thought, yeah, we'll try this guy out. So we did the demos, and then nothing came out of that. So we called him again, and he flew down to L.A., and we all flew to L.A. And we drove to L.A. We drove to L.A., and he flew. And we made this record. It took us about a month, and Butch is really hands-on as a producer and engineer. You know, he's just totally in it all the way. So he's so easygoing and stuff, too.
Well, the first one was recorded. The first one was recorded fairly quickly. Now, were there certain things you set out to do differently this time around, or
it was just an entirely different set of circumstances this time around? You know, entirely different set of circumstances. What did we set out to do different?
It just happened.
It was a different studio.
Yeah.
And different producer and
different state. We just did that whole major label go to Hollywood and record a record thing, but we didn't get stuck with some goofball producer. We got the producer we wanted, you know, and we don't really have any regrets about how it turned out. We think it turned out great and what we did, but I think next time around we're gonna choose a different path because it's such a well-worn path. I'm gonna trot off the beaten track.
What's the different path?
Different path, religion. No, we're gonna record in a church. No, a different path. I don't know. I think we might record the next record as we go along, right? We might record it on a boombox. We might record the record like in an airplane bathroom because of the dynamic acoustics. Just depends, you know. We did our go to Hollywood, just like I said, we did that go to Hollywood trip. Maybe we'll record in somewhere else. Maybe some natural. Oh, we'll record in some Greek theater somewhere in Greece, like the Acropolis or something. Whoa.
Okay, now the first one was done more or less as a live thing.
Yeah.
So this time around, was it consciously like a studio effort and away from the live sound?
I don't think the first album was live. I mean, we recorded it in the studio.
Yeah,
we did overdubs.
We
overdubbed all guitar and vocals and yeah, everything.
Oh, I thought it was one shot.
It was done in like 4 days, or I don't even forget how many days. Under a week, 3, 4, 5 days, something like that. $600. You know what? When we were mixing it, we were really sick, and Kurt went down to the health department, and he got these codeine cough syrups, and we were just popping those, and we were just like in La La Land, and then we were like hands-on producers, just cooking on this codeine joy juice. And I think it had a big effect on how that record turned out. That's the honest truth.
Affect you, this death?
It totally affected me that he actually committed suicide, but also made me think a lot about other people and like how easy it is and how often it happens.
Most teenagers will experience depression. Most will think about suicide by the time they graduate.
when they see it in themselves or in a friend, there are steps they can take. And the most important step is realizing you aren't alone, that you can reach out and find another way out of that pain. Suicide is just a desire to end pain. It is not a desire to die.
Leonard, going after world. So I can't say.
On the set, when the lights come up and the camera starts to roll, there's no place to hide. My hair has to look great. Even one flake is one too many for me. That's why I use Head & Shoulders. Put it to the test. Prove it to yourself. Because great hair can't have flakes.
Head & Shoulders and Head & Shoulders 2-in-1. Dandruff care for great looking hair.
Hurry! Get up Paramount Canada's Wonderland Season Pass now and squeeze 122 days of fun out of just $54.95. For less than the cost of two regular visits, get all the new Paramount fun we've squeezed into the park. Like Days of Thunder, the ultimate simulator ride, plus 10 shows, 50 rides, and 10 acres of water fun, all free with a Season Pass. And hot concerts are only $12 more each. So hurry, buy a pass at the park or Ticketmaster before the price goes up May 16th. And squeeze a whole season of fun out of the best entertainment value around.
Where's everybody? Simple. People are bored with chicken. That's why Subway has our original turkey breast sub. It's oven-roasted turkey on fresh-baked bread with all the trimmings. So if you're tired of the same old chicken, Subway's talking turkey.
The original turkey breast sub at Subway, the place where fresh is the taste.
This is the best part.
Hi, I'm Russell.
And I'm Keith
from Prairie Oyster.
And we want to send one of you and your best friend moonwalking.
Moonwalking? No, that's watching. Moonwalking.
Moonwalking.
Exactly.
Well, actually, Much Music's Outlaws and Heroes want to treat you and a guest to a week of country living and moonwatching during Rodeo Week at the Three Bars Ranch deep in the heart of Dude Ranch Country. To enter, just send the name of Prairie Oyster's latest CD along with your name, address, and phone number to the Prairie Oyster Contest care of Much Music.
I do a book show in Much, where talk to...
You do what?
A book show. Oh. Talk to different people about favorite books that you've read and how it's inspired you or what you learned from it or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So do you have a book that that comes back to you every once in a while?
Yeah, well, I've read Perfume by Patrick Susskind about 10 times in my life, and I can't stop reading it. It's like something that's just stationary in my pocket all the time. It just doesn't leave me, and every time I'm bored, like I'm on an airplane or something, I read it over and over again. Because I'm a hypochondriac, and it just affects me. It makes me want to cut my nose off.
What's the book about?
It's about this perfume apprentice in France at the turn of the century, and he is disgusted, basically, with all humans, and he just can't get away from humans, so he goes on this trek. This walk of death where he goes into the rural areas where there's, you know, woods all over the place and the small villages, and he only travels by night, and he just, every time he smells human, like a fire from a far off way, you know, he'll just get really disgusted and hide, and he just tries to stay away from people, and I kind of relate to that.
Do you ever use what you read in any of your songs?
As a matter of fact, I use that very story in Scentless Apprentice. Yeah. So, that's really one of the first times that I've ever used an actual story, you know, as a book, as an example of a song. You know, I've always tried to stay away from that, but now that I'm running out of ideas more and more, I tend to do that.
Is it hard when, you spend your whole life doing the first few albums, and then suddenly everybody needs your attention. You have to do interviews, you have to travel around, and suddenly is it hard to come up with ideas?
I don't know. I've just noticed that people expect more of a thematic angle with our music. You know, they always want to read into it. And before, I was just using pieces of poetry and just garbage, you know, just stuff that just would spew out of me at the time. And a lot of times when I write lyrics, it's just at the last second because I'm really lazy. So, and then I find myself having to come up with explanations for it, you know. So I thought I'd, you know, prevent that this time and actually have an explanation for some of the songs at least.
There's a lot of baby references in all the songs. I didn't think there would be, but you have like wombs, babies, baby's breath, baby throw up, there's baby everywhere. Is that, this is obviously have become a huge part of your life.
It has been a part of my life before Courtney was even pregnant, though. I've always been just fascinated with medical texts and charts, and I guess I secretly want to be a doctor or something, I don't know. Yeah. Or a person that works in a cremation factory. I don't know. I've always liked anatomy. Ever since I was a little kid, you know, when I first got that little model of the invisible man, you know, or the visible man, it's just something that I like. And since I've become a big rock star and made a bunch of money, I found this place in the Mall of America in Minneapolis that sells nothing but medical stuff. It's a medical supply store that they've offered to the public, you know. It's really great. I bought all these fetuses and, you know, anatomy men and charts and stuff, and it was like a dream come true, you know, because I've always been really poor, and if I could find something like that in a secondhand store, I'd barely have enough money to buy it. And a lot of times I couldn't buy that stuff, so I just went on this rampage of buying all this stuff. And I think I've overused it, you know, for like pictures for the album, and I don't know. I just went overboard on it.
You know the old saying that you can't buy happiness. You think that's true?
Well, you know, because you didn't know if you're going to be able to afford it, and you don't know what you're really looking for, and when you find it, it's more special to you rather than, you know, having $1,000 and going into a store like that and just buying the whole store. You know, it's not as, you know, it's not as special.
Because you've achieved so much success, I mean, so quickly, so surprisingly, you've had a baby, you're married. What excites you now?
My baby and my marriage. I don't know. I still like playing too. I mean, Chris and Dave and I haven't changed at all. I mean, believe it or not, we get along just as well as we ever did. You know, we're just as the same passive aggressive people as we used to be. You know, we never fight. You know, we're pissed off at each other. We just hold it under our breath and have respect for one another in that way. You know, it's just it's easier to work that way. You know, because we have a mission, I guess.
Can you feel my love? Can you feel my love? Can you feel my love? smells like Teen Spirit. Were there things that were more obvious in that album than others? Were there not statements? I hate talking about statements, but especially that first that first song, that first statement, that first video.
What? Statement is like,
yeah.
Every month I get a bank statement, and I'm usually overdrawn. And
so we're not into making statements.
I don't know, statements can be made anywhere, you know. There's a lot to be said for subtleties.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
there's a lot to be said for being cryptic also.
Yeah.
Cryptic?
Yeah, mysterious.
So you can just like,
because we just can't explain ourselves. We don't consciously think about our music, so we can't explain it. Therefore, interviews are worthless. Let's go. What do you think about interviews?
It's a pretty good magazine. Really,
did you hear my reaction when he asked me if I wanted to do one?
Yeah.
I said, no. I said, heck no.
You were an interview magazine right next to Shonen Knife. And you know who was on the cover?
Mm-hmm.
Matt Dillon.
Yeah, well, that's funny because, I mean, Cameron Crowe's doing a... No, but I mean, it's funny you talk about Cameron Crowe's doing a movie with Matt Dillon in Seattle.
Yeah.
And there are many musicians, Seattle musicians in that movie. Are you part of it at all?
No
part whatsoever.
No.
We opted not to delve in the movie
Candy,
directed by Ron Howard. It was about this rock and roll band. And what was the evil rock and roll band name?
I don't know, was the other one with Leif Garrett in it?
Oh, that's
Leif Garrett?
Leif Garrett. I've seen all these rock and roll movies, and it's always, you know, the star. There's either Leif Garrett in it, or...
There's never been a really good documentary on rock and roll
except
bands.
For Spinal Tap was the only rock
Tap.
Movie worth watching.
Oh, and Don't Look Back by Bob Dylan.
That's true.
You seen that?
No.
Very, very good.
Oh, it's a good movie. It's old, made in 1964.
Makes a fool out of Donovan.
It's a rockumentary.
So I mean, were you approached? Were you asked to be part of that movie at all? No.
Anything. You know what I mean?
Oh no, they did ask us.
Really? Yeah, they asked John.
Oh, I said no.
I said no before even asking you guys.
Oh.
That's because I'm the leader of the band.
You blew my chance, man. I'm gonna roll into Hollywood. I'm gonna have a star on Hollywood Boulevard, and I'm gonna have a big house with a swimming pool and all these cars, and I'm gonna get divorces and stuff. And I'm gonna have a big drug.
Jethro on TV's Beverly Hillbillies. Tell me about that. That Seattle thing everybody's been talking about. I mean, there's been that Manchester scene. There's that Seattle scene now. I mean, is it relevant at all?
All scenes are relevant, but they all eventually phase into nothing, or you know, they go away after a while.
They eventually
become
a parody of themselves.
People put too much emphasis on scenes. I mean, just because there happens to be a town with a few really good bands in it, I mean, big deal. It's happened all over the place, in Minneapolis, in LA, in New York, all over the place. So it's really no big deal. I don't understand this, like, community patriotism that everyone is boasting about in Seattle, because like they're claiming that they finally put Seattle on the map, you know, but like, what map?
Now the
who
rents
cares?
Are going up.
Yeah, everyone's moving to Seattle. I mean, we had Jimi Hendrix. Heck, what more do we want?
We went to his grave once, and there was a guitar picks and beer bottles all over it. And we went to Bruce Lee's grave at like 1:30 in the morning. It's really wild. It was like in the Chinese part of the cemetery.
There were punchy sticks and nunchucks laying all over the place.
We thought for sure there was these ninjas creeping behind these tombstones. We're like, whoa. But then again, the state of mind we were in at the time would be like...
But ninja turtles.
But do you feel that since everybody's been talking about Seattle, still, did you feel that it helped you in any ways, getting that recording contract, or it has nothing to do with it?
It might have.
I suppose it did.
We were in on.
We're grateful for it, I guess.
What about that show tonight? Is it different from one night to another? Is it something you like being on tour, or would you just like to stick by the recording studios and do some more songs?
Touring is wonderful.
See.
Get to eat on the road. You get to sit in a van like this and like be jostled for like 8 hours a day.
You get free alcohol every night.
Mm-hmm.
Well, who can ask for more? Yeah. It's a party every night.
You know,
you go to
cauliflower
like the last couple nights.
That's cream cheese.
Yeah, or like some sort of chive dip. It's been right on.
You gotta keep solid if you're crogging down those beers, you know? So it's good to eat a lot of veggies and cheese and stuff, because I think my insides start to swell after a while, you know? It's just like not a very pleasant experience. Well, it's pleasant when I'm drunk, but like. Thank you, guys.
More and more, I get this feeling that I've gone crazy. My most recent preoccupation has been with my red scarf and my neck. I strangle myself until I gasp. When I picture death, it frightens me. Yet living this way is torture, too. What am I to do? We're going to head up to the Manic Depressive Association. It's on the second floor up here.
It's been a big help for you?
It's been one of the best. It just dispels the main feeling that you're alone. Here, everyone's working like busy beavers to try and uncover more information on depression and manic depression.
Right.
The first way I found to get better was to accept that you have the illness and then to arm yourself with information. And then the main part of my, you know, my routine of staying better is coming here for support groups. When you talk to people who have actually lived through the ups, the downs, people of all different ages, people just diagnosed, people who've had it for 10 years, you get a different spectrum. And then you feel like you belong. There's a sense of belonging. And this is where we do it.
Today in music history.
You know that this whole grunge thing, that this in quotations grunge, all I want to know is, where did the term come from?
I have no idea. I think some of the rumors are that Jonathan Poneman said it one time sarcastically, and it just caught on.
Who's that?
He's one of the head honchos at Sub Pop Records. But, no one set out to market this music as that, you know, just, you know, that's what happens on the main media. The media catches on. They have to call it something. I like it as much as New Wave. I would have been proud to be a New Waver, you know, 15 years ago.
Oh yeah, well, we were about the same age. I was into New Wave, absolutely. Do you think you have some of the same, is there anything the same between your music and New Wave?
I think so.
Like what?
Well, like, you know, New Wave was just a progression from punk rock and a mutation of punk rock, you know, and it was more commercial, more palatable, you know. It had, you know, punk rock roots, and it was easier to swallow for the media and middle America and the middle of the world, and it just, you know, that's what I kind of think about our music.
Are you worried about a Nirvana backlash?
Hasn't that already been over with? Hasn't that already happened? I don't know. Sure, I don't know.
Okay. What else I want to talk to you about?
But we're getting more New Wave as the days go by. I think we're going to reinvent New Wave and bring back breakdancing. I'd really like to bring back New Wave and breakdancing. You know, meld it to something. I don't know. That's what our new music is sounding like. We're using a lot more effects boxes, and we haven't resorted to skinny ties, but we're gonna, I think our music's, you know, this album's like the closing of the chapter of the formula we've been using, you know? It's like grunge is, it's really kind of boring for us, you know? It's something we can't deny, and we're not gonna stop playing the old songs live, whoops. And, but, you know, our tastes are just changing so rapidly that we're really experimenting with a lot of stuff, and it might get too indulgent and be really embarrassing for the next album, but we can't put out another album, and this is just like the last chapter of three chord grunge music for us. And it was an easy thing to do and a safe thing to do because we knew it's still popular, you know, but we had to get it out of our systems.
How come you are so nice, and you seem so comfortable with yourself. Something must have really happened in the last couple of years. Is it just falling in love?
No.
What happened?
I've always been a nice guy.
Maybe you were afraid to show up before. How's that?
Well, But I don't know, you've never met me before.
I never met you before, but I know that other people who have had the opportunity to interview you, and they said, oh, he hates doing interviews, he's not going to want to talk about anything. Yeah. I said, well, you know, whatever, who knows? And you're just like exactly the opposite of...
It just depends on what mood I'm in, really. Yeah, I'm kind of a moody person, and a lot of times when someone has had the chance to talk to me, I've probably been on tour or I've probably gone through an exhausted time where I've talked about myself for hours and hours, and this week I haven't had to talk about myself very much, so
lucky
probably
me.
More cooperative.
I think one of the interesting things about Nirvana that you don't really talk about that much is that you're very concerned about sexism. I like that. That's good. So how do you make people aware of that problem?
By writing songs as blunt as Rape Me. Having to resort to doing something like that is almost embarrassing because people didn't understand when we wrote a song like About a Girl or Polly, and having to explain that and having misunderstandings about it, I decided to write Rape Me in a way that was just so blunt and obvious that it's like no one could deny it, you know? No one could read into it any other way, you know? Although some people have, actually, because some of the lyrics in it, some people have thought that maybe it has something to do with my disgust with the media and the way they've treated us and stuff like that, but it's not true. That's not what the song's about at all. It's just my way of, in a sarcastic way almost, of like just saying how obvious do we have to be, you know? And I guess we don't talk about those kind of things that, you know, that are really important to us because I don't want to be thought of as like nothing more than a PC band, you know? I mean, we're entertainers, you know? That's what music is, and so it's really hard to, you know, step over the lines, you know?
It's that you have so much power because that camera's on you. You can use it.
Yeah, well, we try to use our power. I mean, we've really have been effective in certain ways, like being associated with this organization called FAIR, and I can't remember right now because I have a mental block of exactly what it stands for, but it's something like, I can't remember. but they're an organization who looks at the injustices they look at the details that around that surrounds certain issues and certain stories that have been reported in magazines and newspapers like USA Today, who tend to, you know, look over a lot of the facts, and they're pretty much a leftist organization that tries to protect people in certain areas, you know, and they supposedly try as hard as they can to, you know, to deliver the truth. And so, you know, we've done benefits like that for like No on Nine benefits to try to stop Portland's anti-gay laws that they were trying to pass, and we did a Bosnian benefit and stuff like that. And, you know, it doesn't seem like much, but, you know, we raised like $50,000 for the Bosnian rape victims, you know, and that's a lot more than we could have done griping about it and talking about it in the interviews and like maybe putting out a fanzine, you know. There's nothing wrong with doing stuff like that, but, you know, we're using the tools that we have, you know, and we're being effective as much as we can. But we still don't want to be too political at the same time, you know, because it's just kind of embarrassing to do that. Or, you know, you get a lot of ridicule for it.
Yeah, but you're doing what you believe in. That's the most important thing.
It's hard not to, you know. I mean, if you're put in this position, what are you going to do? You become a Republican or something? You know? Just to protect what you've earned, big deal.
Mom and Dad went to a show. They dropped me off at Grandpa Joe's. I kicked and screamed, so please be gone. Grandma, take me home. 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 Grandma, take me home.
You have left behind a precious being by the name of Frances Bean. She will never grow up without a father. She will now grow up without a father because of your selfish act of committing suicide. And for that, I am angry at you. But I know in time she will grow to forgive you, and so will we all. You have meant something special to us, and we will never forget that wonderful music you have left behind for us to remember you by. I just wanted this chance to say goodbye, for I never got the chance before.
I'm so happy, 'cause today found my friends in my head. I'm so ugly, that's okay, 'cause so are you. Book of years, Sunday morning is every day for all I care. And I'm not scared, light my candles in our days, 'cause I found God. Yeah. So lonely, that's okay, shake my head, and I'm not sad, and just maybe I'm to blame for all I've heard, and I'm not sure, I'm so excited, I can't wait to meet you there, and I don't care, I'm so horny, that's okay, my will is good. Today I found my friends and in my head. I'm so ugly, that's okay, 'cause so are you. Broke on ears, Sunday morning is every day for all I care. And I'm not scared, light my candles in our days, 'cause I found God. Yeah, yeah.
People's problems might be too extreme, or they think they're too extreme, and they get kind of scared, and they just like, I don't know what to do, I can't talk to anyone, so they, you know, they could keep it all to themselves, and they might eventually just break down completely. because I've seen it happen. It's so much stress and everything just comes down on you at once, and it's, I don't know, it's, some people, it can make them sick. It's so awful.
Everybody says it's just a stage you go through right now, but well, what if it sort of never ends? Yeah. You just stay down,
go down in a hole sometimes.
How do you handle depression and being depressed?
Well, sometimes you have to talk to friends. I find, like, I'm lucky, I think, because I have a few close friends and a girlfriend who really listens.
I write poetry, and I drink tea and stuff, and then I call friends.
I talk
to Blair here. Yeah, we talk to each other. Yeah, we just go out and battle it out, and she tells me what's wrong with her, and I tell her what's wrong with me.
And help each other out.
The cover of the new record, is there a certain concept you guys are trying to put across with the cover?
It's open for interpretation. You know, think about a baby swimming through water, dollar bill on a hook. You know, that's a fun part of it. Decipher. Maybe a person could find a new way of life. So we're speaking of paths. They can take off their clothes and bite into a fish hook in water. See how that feels!
Well, I sort of thought it related to the band, though, this is sort of your first jump in the water towards the huge bucks and all that.
I never thought of that. There you go. That works, too. See? It's something for interpretation.
And that's the whole idea? You guys don't like explaining anything to do with your music or to do with what you're doing.
Just like freaking Ricardo said, splain, Lucy, splain. Lucy never did.
Ricky!
Okay, now why don't you like talking about it, though? What's the problem with going on camera and just relating a little story to do with it?
There's nothing to be said. It's all in the music, man. It's all in the music. It's all in the meat.
You don't think that people that are fans of you would like to hear what you had in mind, maybe, or...
I want to hear what they have in mind, you know? Yeah, or how they interpret it.
You would.
Cool. Yeah, I'd like to get some letters. This is what my analytical idea is, what critical lyrics are about, you know? It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter, man.
You know what we do is we get all drunk and we get in these heavy philosophical conversations. What we are is we're pothead philosophers with no type of studious background or anything. We just...
what's your relationship now with Sub Pop? How are things with them?
Oh, we get along with those guys. I mean, we stop by and say hi, and that's about it, really. We're pretty much off the label. We're on DGC. DGC does all the work.
So there was a Sub Pop logo, though, on the first single or whatever?
Yeah, it's going to be on the record, too. It's a contractual obligation, basically. That's it.
Okay. Now, was there a little bit of bad blood at first, though, wasn't there, when you guys were leaving?
Yeah, it was. I think a lot of that was lack of communication and assumptions, but now we put all that behind us now, and we just get along. There's no reason to bear a grudge, right? Forgive and forget, huh, brother?
Now, are you going to come back after a certain period of time and do, like, a freebie single or anything like Soundgarden did, or...?
A freebie single? Just like my Uncle Jim said, nothing in this world is free. But, I don't know, we'll probably do something like that. It's always fun to release things. Maybe we'll just go and release something, you know. Maybe we'll record a record with people on work release. So, see, because if they want to get on work release, you have to have a job guarantee. So they'll get out of jail that way. So we'll just like guarantee them a job, and they'll get out of jail. We're out to help our friends.
Actually, scratched into the Runoff Grooves in the Cat Butt 12-inch was something about if the man from Geffen shows up, shoot him in the head or something like that. No. Do you guys know anything about that? No?
No.
No, it was something I discovered just recently. I thought it was really ironic.
First time we heard of it.
So it's a Cat Butt single that came out a long time ago?
12-inch sub-pop thing.
It came out a long time ago?
Yeah.
Huh. Maybe they had a bad experience with somebody at Geffen.
Well, I just wondered if Geffen had been sort of around trying to sign up other...
Yeah. Geffen tried to sign Cat Butt, huh?
Okay, so now we've just got a brand new video from you guys. And does somebody want to tell me about that, or you don't want to explain that? It's just there to for everyone's own interpretation. Who'd you do the video with?
Napoleon. We did it with Max Baer, TV's Jethro, on the Beverly Hillbillies. Oh, it was Sam Baer, wrong guy. Well, this guy, no, this video takes place in a high school gym, and it's like a crazy pep assembly. It's Plum Loco.
Okay, now why'd you use that song for the video, first single and all that?
We just kind of said, hey, what songs you guys wanted to put out first as a single? And we just thought about it. Oh, I say this song, oh, I say that song. And we thumb wrestled, and we thought Teen Spirit. Let's do Teen Spirit as our first single.
Now, doesn't Smell Like Teen Spirit, isn't that from a deodorant commercial or something? Is that where you guys got it from?
No, we didn't get it from we found that out later. Pure coincidence.
It is pure coincidence, yeah. It's such a big world. You know, it's a small world. It's kind of a medium-sized world. Like if you put the planet Earth between Jupiter and like Uranus, which is really small, it's like medium.
Okay.
Did you know that the biggest star in the universe, in the whole galaxy universe, is as big as an atom is small? Did you know that? Isn't that wild? That's more pothead philosophy.
Now, in between the last Sub Pop thing and this album, there seems to have been a lot of bootlegs released. I just wondered how you guys felt about.
We don't mind the live stuff. That's fine.
It's just when they start bootlegging stuff that's unreleased and wasn't intended for release in the first place. That's when it starts getting kind of hairy.
So you actually prefer the live bootlegs to actual studio?
Sure. Well, they always sound like crap anyway. I mean, whether it's live.
Whoa! Into the interview?
Okay.
All
right.
That's it. We're out.
How's
music done by the Canadian government.
Yeah.
Is it national?
Yeah.
They can pay for it.
It's all right.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, thanks a lot, you guys.
Thanks.
As a friend, as a friend, as I'm
personally cope with having relationships, private relationships that are always being scrutinized publicly? It must be really difficult.
Well, it is, but I mean, I still have a lot of the same friends that I used to have, so they don't seem to mind, and that isn't ever really exposed too much, you know. No one writes about how me and my friend Dylan walked down the street and, you know, did whatever. But
yeah, but they rip apart you and Courtney. They love to do that.
Yeah, I don't know why, but you know, we're just I don't know. I guess like my ego could be talking right now, and I could say, well, we're interesting people, you know. But I think we're just easy scapegoats. It's just, you know, it started with something, and then, you know, people just pick up on it and carry it along, and we turn into cartoon characters, and there's nothing I can do about it, really. You know, I can threaten to sue, and, you know, try to you know, bring up libel laws and stuff like that to people that write shit like that about us. But, you know, if you've ever looked into that, it's pretty much a lost cause. You have to have a lot of money to do that. And, you know, I could spend the money that I earned last year all on fighting the Vanity Fair piece, you know, and they'd end up winning because they had more money, you know. So
There's a magazine in Canada that incorporates itself for each issue, and then it goes bankrupt on each issue so that it could write whatever it wants and no one could ever sue them.
Wow, that's a pretty smart thing to do.
Yeah, it is.
That kind of reminds me of how a lot of stations in the States got a hold of our new album, but it was like someone had anonymously sent them like fifth generation cassette copies of our new album, and in order for them to play it, they started on the weekend at 5 o'clock, like on Friday nights. That way they could play it throughout the rest of the weekend without having the council, you know, sue them. And that's kind of smart. <You know?
laughs> It's free publicity for you anyway. Ultimately, the album's going to come out.
That's true, but the thing is that there's been so much controversy about how bad the record sounds, you know, and how lo-fi it is. And to hear it like that compared to all the other songs that were on the radio that night, it really disgusted me, and it pissed me off because it sounded terrible. It sounded really, really bad. And then everyone that heard it that weekend is going to say, yeah, you're right. Okay, the stories are true. Then the Ron album really sucks, and I'm not going to buy it, you know, so it just kind of bothered me, but we took care of it.
What'd you do?
Well, I thought maybe we should hire a lawyer to stop them to do it, then instead I just decided to hire a hitman.
Pardon me?
Nothing. Erase that. No, we just called them up on Monday and told them to stop.
And they went, oh, okay.
Well, our lawyer did that. Mm.
Isn't that a weird world for you to suddenly have lawyers and, like, people who do stuff like that for you?
Yeah. It's totally unnecessary, too. If we weren't in this position, we wouldn't need lawyers, you know? It's just, it's totally unnecessary, and we have to spend a lot of money just to protect ourselves all the time, and it's just stupid.
When did that first hit you? When did you realize that you're going to need some people on your team to protect you from the vultures?
Too late. You know, much after the fact, after we'd already been damaged to a point where you know, almost didn't do any good, you know. But, I don't know, it was just a weird realization one day, you know. Wow, I have to, you know, and I can see how, like, rock and roll stars will all of a sudden, will almost compromise their music to make sure that they sell the same amount of records next year because they've spent all their money on lawyers and protecting themselves last year, you know? But, I mean, we obviously haven't done that. I mean, I don't know, maybe you might not have noticed, but the record isn't as commercial as the last one, so we could never bring ourselves to do that, you know? I'd rather just laugh about it and
I was talking to Amy Mann, a girl from Till Tuesday. She was at her office just a couple days ago. She's on tour with Ray Davies or the Kinks, and Ray Davies was in the office also. He came in before her. And I had mentioned to her that he was very nice, but really eccentric when I was talking to him, kind of nutty. And she said, well, you know, there's a lot of people who have been around the record business for those many years, and most of them are kind of nutty. It just, you know, it makes people nutty.
Yeah.
I mean, you're facing that. That's your future.
Yeah, that's my future. Hopefully we'll put out Metal Machine music next year, you know? I don't know. Either I've accepted it or I've gone beyond insane to where I can deal with it emotionally. I know that I'm too stubborn to allow myself to ever compromise our music or, you know, get so wrapped up in it and involved to where it's going to, you know, turn us into big rock stars. I mean, I just don't feel like that. Everyone else accuses us of it, but, you know, we're not as popular as everyone thinks, or we're not as rich as everyone thinks, you know? We've always had a good sense of humor. I don't think that's been translated very well, you know, but we'd rather laugh about it.
You know what really surprised me, though, is you're pretty bright, and your lyrics are, and just your whole stage persona is pretty angry, angst-ridden, frustrated. I mean, you see the world for what it is. Did you ever have second thoughts about bringing a child into the world the way it is?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah. I really can't describe what changed our attitude so fast. I think, you know, I really was a lot more negative and angry and everything else a few years ago, but that had a lot to do with not having a mate, you know, not having a steady girlfriend and stuff like that. So that was one of the main things that was bothering me that I wouldn't admit at the time, you know. So now that I've found that, the world seems a lot better for some reason, you know. It really does change your attitude about things, you know. I mean, 4 years ago I would have said, you know, the classic thing like, you know, how dare someone bring a child into this life, you know. It's just completely a terrible way to go, and, you know, the world's going to explode any day and stuff like that. But once you fall in love, it's a bit different.
Some people have nobody to go to.
Can you talk to the school?
No.
Can you talk
It's easier to talk to people your own age.
So do you think that most kids who have problems actually come to people to seek help out, or do you think there's lots of them out there that just, for whatever reason...
I think a lot of them don't. I think a lot of them
may try. They may say something or do something to try and get an adult to notice, but for whatever reason, the adult doesn't notice or doesn't pick up the message, and so they get discouraged and don't ask for help again. And so they, you know, talk a lot to their friends and try and get some support that way, but that's not always enough, and it doesn't resolve the problems.
You are watching our tribute to Kurt Cobain and the music of Nirvana. Still half an hour to go. I'm going to see some more stuff in Holland and much uncut and rare stuff that we don't get to show you very often and perhaps won't show it ever again. We would like to say, though, that even though we're not stressing so much on the problems and difficulties that Kurt Cobain had in dealing with success and with life in general, this show is really to celebrate the music of Nirvana. We realize that there are people with problems out there, there are people that feel depressed, that don't have a handle on things. Maybe it's addiction, maybe you just don't feel like you can wake up in the morning and handle it. We do have some phone numbers. We'll give the kids' help phone again because it is 24 hours and it is national. It's 1-800-668-6868. So if you do have any problems, whatever it may be, the people are there to help you out and do what we can. Well, that's it for me, almost half an hour to go, as I said, with the Kurt Cobain tribute. And that's it. That's all I have to say.
I think it's a great tragedy that a genius such as Kurt Cobain was driven by society to do what he did. Just basically destroyed all hope I have left for the world we live in, society and humanity in general. All the people that are saying, oh, he's a role model to all these kids, look what he had going for him, his wife, his son, all that. I mean, that's just, you people don't even understand depression at all, so you have no basis to make statements like that.
It was a waste, a big waste.
Such a beautiful artist.
Yeah, he was so beautiful. I mean, like, I don't know, he brought happiness to everybody in his music.
Yes.
And
he's a babe too.
Yeah, he's a babe.
Shame box, cold weeks.
Meet anyone who would be like your hero? Anyone that you're real pleased they got to meet?
Yeah. That's kind of a positive side of being a rock and roll star. But no, actually, I met Iggy Pop before we were rock and roll stars. And Iggy Pop is pretty much the only person that I met that I really, really admire and like. And
when you met him, were you pleased?
Yeah, it was a big excitement. It was great. I didn't ask him for an autograph. I tried not to bother him the way that I thought that I might be bothered, but I don't know. And then the other person is William Burroughs. I met him, and and I actually got to put out a record with him, so.
Yeah, tell me about the record that you're doing with Glenn Burroughs.
Well, it's already out. It's just a 10-inch. It's just one story of his called The Priest They Called Him. And I just, it was a long-distance recording. He'd recorded his version, and then I just played a bunch of guitar noises in the background, and then mixed it somewhere else, and it came out. And now we're talking about putting out a whole album.
Wow.
Yeah.
Of him reading his work and you playing guitar underneath?
Yeah, I think I'll play a bunch of instruments this time instead of just, you know, fucking off like I did before. You know, it was just a last minute thing where I just made a bunch of noise, but this time I'd like to kind of work on it. Maybe I'll do a Muzak version.
I'm sure my bros would love that, a little bit of Muzak. Let me just make sure I have all my questions asked, and this is one that I... Oh, Tori Amos, did you like the cover of this record?
Well, it served a purpose because we used that as the opening. Before we came out, we'd play that song.
Oh, really?
And we'd come out and dance to it, do a little bit of interpretive dancing to it. Yeah, it was nice. Yeah.
The last thing I want to ask you about is, I'm not sure who in your band said it. It could have been you, could have been someone else, but someone being a little perturbed by them, your mainstream audience, and wanting to just make music for your real fans.
Well, you know, a couple of years ago when we were making these bold negative statements about things like that, you know, we were really confused and we were scared, we were afraid that we would lose a lot of our audience that meant a lot to us because they're people that, you know, we supposedly hopefully feel that we have a connection with, you know, the college students and people in the underground. I don't think we've lost them. I think they're still fans, so I'm not worried about it anymore. And I was at the time.
Clearly a wonderful show from the world-famous Dancing Poodles. Next, ladies and gentlemen, we have three fine young men from Seattle. They're coming. Hold on, they're coming. They're thoroughly all right and decent fellows with their hit single, In Bloom. Here they are, Nirvana.
Oh,
things about them. They're going to be really big stars. Let's give a big hand to Nirvana.
Some assignments are tougher than others. This is one of the toughest. This is attending the Kurt Cobain Memorial at Seattle Center. Some 10,000 people in this area. It used to be the site of the World's Fair, right underneath the Space Needle. And they've come here out of grief and frustration, some of them out of anger. Anger at being abandoned by one of their heroes. But everybody came for one reason, to pay their respects to Kurt Cobain. And yes, there were eulogies. Yes, there were people from all walks of life. Whole families were here. But it wasn't until a tape was played from Courtney Love that literally the place and time stood still.
I don't really think it takes away his dignity to read this, considering that it's addressed to most of you. He's such an asshole. I want you all to say asshole really loud. I haven't felt the excitement of listening to as well as creating music along with really writing something for too many years now. I feel guilty beyond words about these things. On our last three tours, I got a much better appreciation of all the people I've known personally and as fans of our music, but I still can't get out the frustration, the guilt, or the empathy I have for everybody. There's good in all of us. And I simply love people too much. So why didn't you just fucking stay? So much that it makes me feel too fucking sad. Thank you all from the pit of my burning, nauseous stomach for your letters and concern during the last years. I'm too much of an erratic, moody person, and I don't have the passion anymore. And so remember, and don't remember this, because this is a fucking lie. It's better to burn out than to fade away. God, you asshole. Peace, love, empathy, Kurt Cobain.
What else should I be? I'll apologize.
Everybody getting together here is a very important thing, to let a lot of stuff go and to show each other that there are other people feeling the same way that you feel.
My friends and I, like, were talking the other day, and we were, like, thinking, like, comparing Kurt Cobain to Jim Morrison, just because, like, he kind of got the Seattle...
Into the
grunge. He's, like, the one that kind of got Seattle on the map. Yeah, and it's like, he was this great performer, and he was really good in concerts, and he had this great music, and now all of a sudden he's gone.
You just gotta move on, you know? It's a tragedy. And it is a tragedy, but you gotta move on. You gotta think about what he did do, and not what he... You gotta think of his musical talents, what he did. And just don't think about that tragic morning whenever he chose to take his own life.
Kurt Cobain has killed himself, and we are left as survivors to make sense of this death. There is anger, there are feelings of sadness. We don't understand why. And the difficult part about suicides are that the answers are taken away with Kurt. He knew the whys. We don't all know all the reasons.
On behalf of Dave, Pat, and I would like to thank you all for your concern at this time. We remember Kurt for what he was, caring, generous, and sweet. Let's keep the music with us. We'll always have it, forever. Kurt had an ethic toward his fans that was rooted in the punk rock way of thinking. No band is special, no player royalty. That's the level that Kurt spoke to us on, in our hearts. And that's where he and the music will always be, forever.
I was really angry at Kurt Cobain for what he did, so I came to mourn the loss of Nirvana, more or less. I'm still angry.
Sounded like Courtney was angry,
too. That really affected me a lot. That really influenced how I feel about this, and I'm glad I came down here and heard it.
Yeah, I'm really kind of worried about Courtney now at this point, you know. I mean, she's had a rough time with the media before, and I could just see that a lot of people would make a field day out of this. So I hope she looks out for herself.
Who do you think's come here today?
I think people that are just looking for some place to be where they can share their thoughts with friends and other people that understand. I guess it's sort of a way for the community to say goodbye.
Is all we are. Oh, no, is all we are. Oh,
music that's depressing. It's usually uplifting. I mean, just the idea that maybe somebody else is just as depressed as you are, maybe makes you step outside of your own depression and think that maybe you're being a little bit overbearing, possibly.
I think music helps you to express yourself and express your feelings, and sometimes people find it hard to talk about the feelings, so they listen to music, and it just helps them work it out in their mind.
What happened after the Kurt Cobain suicide here in Vancouver?
Our concern was that a lot of youth would want to follow in his footsteps. The youth who listen to his music and think, yeah, he's feeling what I feel, and then say, he did this, I guess I'll do the same thing. That's our great concern, and we've had a lot of calls from youth who do have those thoughts, who are afraid they might take that step, or who can't see any other choice because Kurt went ahead of them and they want to follow. However, in those calls, generally they discover there are other things they can try, other things they can do to deal with the pain. Kurt chose his method, but they can choose a different one.
No matter where we live, in the city or the country, we must be ready for a new...
We're in Nottingham Rock City and it's freezing. It's going to be getting hot a bit later because Nirvana are playing here tonight. The single is currently number 7 in the charts and the current Youth UK tour is sold out everywhere.
So we decided to start a band, and initially the band was just a Creedence Clearwater cover band to play in bars and hopefully make enough money to where we could buy some art supplies. But people caught on. These rednecks in our hometown started taking off their big 10-gallon hats and going, "Woohoo! You guys are great!" And all of a sudden we decided, well, maybe we can make some more money at this. To heck with art, because music isn't art.
They had a peculiarity. Instead of clapping, they'd grab their suspenders and flip them.
was really wild. Well, whatever, whatever the charts.
Yeah, but in distribution, you know, they got out and
yeah,
did a good job at distributing.
Yeah, DGC is a great company. They really know how to promote us, and I see our records everywhere, in every store we go into. It's really nice to know people can buy it anytime.
That's basically what we wanted. We just wanted people to have a chance to buy our record. We didn't know that so many people would buy it.
We weren't prepared for it, and it's never been a main goal of ours. You know, we really don't care about anything like that. We just want to put out a good record, and hopefully the people who liked our first album would like this one also. And I mean, of course we want to make a comfortable living at it, to at least be able to eat, you know, and travel on tour. But as far as like getting in the top 10, we don't care at all. We know it won't happen, you know, it won't last for very long, so.
Especially, like, hopefully, we just want that, like where we come from, like the underground or the alternative scene, people, if they buy our record and they like it, they'll try to find out where we came from, and they'll discover bands like Sonic Youth, Melvins, Dinosaur Jr. I just go on and on. Not Penny. Blah 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 blah. And
Shonen Knight.
Shonen Knight. Captain America. Just kind of change things. Kind of kick off the old guard. Bring some freshness back in music. I don't know if the mainstream deserves it, but mankind might be redeemable. So the underground's always been there.
Yeah, it's always been available to the public. It's just that there haven't been very many opportunities for bands who are aware of underground music to promote it, you know, in a mainstream sense. It doesn't happen very often, so people forget after a few years, like, you know, the Sex Pistols were in the top 10 years ago.
Clash.
The Clash, the Ramones, Blondie. It's always been there.
Plus, it was just a good friend of ours who did the strings.
Yeah,
it wasn't like some hired studio musician.
Yeah, it wasn't. In fact, we knew we wanted string. We knew we wanted a cello on one song, but we kind of forgot about it until the last day. There was only like one more day to do it, and we were at a party, and we decided to ask our friends if they knew anyone who played cello, and it just so happens one of our good friends played, so we brought him in the next day, and he did it.
In the whole world.
What do you like about
it? They're just so raw, the music. It's just got so much power in it. So it's brilliant.
I could see you wearing a Nirvana t-shirt.
Yeah.
Been to see them many times before?
Oh, I've been twice this year already, and I'm going again in London, so I'm a bit of a fan, really. So.
And so, have you bought the latest album?
Yeah, I've got both of them, yeah. I've been to see them about 3 times before.
Which album do you prefer?
The latest one's the best, I think, definitely.
Why do you like it the best?
I don't know, I just play it all the time. It's always played in our kitchen. It's our favourite.
And what's your favourite track on the new album?
Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Do you think of a show tonight?
Oh, bloody brilliant.
Yeah?
Getting excellent, no worries.
Were you down the front?
Yeah, right to the front. Oh, some at Sheffield on Thursday. No worries there, but even better today.
Was it pretty wild down the front tonight?
Not as wild as Saturday. No, not Saturday, Sheffield. But we're alright.
Have you seen him before this tour?
No. I haven't seen him at Reading, but we'll get a ticket.
Have
you been a fan of theirs for some time?
About 15 months. So.
Right. So was it mostly since Nevermind came out that you've been to them? Have you got Bleach as well?
Bleach. You got Bleach. You got the import, Sliver. Sliver import. Uh-huh. That's well sung. Best song ever, that.
Will you be going to see them again on this
Yeah.
tour? Where are you going to?
I don't know, wherever I can get a ticket.
Okay, thanks very much. So how long have you been a fan of Nirvana?
Since I first heard of Sub Pop, I suppose. The Sub Pop race.
Have you seen them many times before?
About four or five times. And this is the second lot of t-shirts I bought. These are for friends. Crimbo Prezzes, by the way.
And do you like the new album?
Stonking. Absolutely superb. You couldn't have asked for more off Nirvana, really.
There are a lot of people in the town, and usually when there's a large city, there are a lot of bands. I don't know why they're all good, but those bands that you just mentioned, Tad, Mudhoney, and Soundgarden, are pretty much the only bands from Seattle I personally have liked. The rest of them I don't really care for that much, so I think there are at least a handful of good bands in every city.
We grew up on industry rock. While we were young, you know, like Led Zeppelin and Aerosmith and stuff like that, and earlier on we were into the Beatles. But I think the style of music that most affected us while we were teenagers was punk rock. It pretty much changed our lives. It made us realize that you don't have to be a good musician, you just have to appreciate music and understand passion. You just want to have a good time.
Punk rock to a child with adrenaline problems is like a dream come true.
How have we defined our music? Rock and roll, punk rock, music.
Hard rock. Hard pop rock. Hard pop rocks popping on your tongue. Crickling and crackling.
Maybe R.E.M.
Yeah, R.E.M.'s great.
It just seems that, you know, a lot of the mainstream commercial bands are just, you know, they're just mega money machines, and they're not willing to do anything different because
it's not challenging musically,
and it's not same financially feasible, you know.
A lot of the rock bands are just like Aerosmith, Hanoi Rocks, Rehashers, you know, to the point where all the singers look the same, guitar players have the same moves, the same sound. It's a commodity, is all it is.
You don't really have control over it, though, in certain areas. I mean, if people are going to write about you, really, you can't do anything about it. All you can do is refuse to do interviews. I mean, you're still going to get your pictures taken, and, you know, they're going to write about you if they want to or not. So, in that sense, there's nothing you can do about it. But I don't think that if you have the same values that we do, there's any threat of us like being sucked into the way of thinking that most corporate labels do. You know, we're not going to just worry about our career in the business sense of it at all. It doesn't matter. It never has, so there's no reason for us to change now. Everyone that we work with, we work with well. You know, they understand us, so there's no threat of that, I don't think.
I think that mentality has been pretty much exhausted by this time. I mean, we have been proven by our fans that they still like us. I mean, we've sold out all the shows on this tour, and there's still a lot of people who were into our earlier album or into it now, so you know, I don't think it really matters anymore. And bands like Sonic Youth and us and Dinosaur Jr. and a lot of other bands like the Pixies, you know, have proven that you can be on a major and still do what you want. It's just a new thing, so it'll take a while for people to realize it.
But I've not been to see them before.
So have you heard anything about what the gigs are like?
Crap. Shut up. Apparently they're Reading very good.
£6.50.
But I didn't bother to go and see them. I just thought about laying my tent all day.
We hear a bit raucous.
Raucous. Yeah. Apparently I'm Top of the Pops with shit. But my boyfriend's giving me a load of stick about coming to see them.
Have you got the Nevermind album?
No, I've got Bleach.
£7.50.
Yeah, I think it's brilliant.
What is it that you like most about the band?
They've got a lot of bollocks, really. They've got a lot of energy in them. Yeah, they're just not. They're pretty they've gone in the charts, really. It puts me off a bit because they've gone in the charts.
Really? Because They're in the singles charts?
You get a lot of dickheads at the concerts, though. You know, just here because they're in the charts, but...
So would you prefer it if they remained undiscovered?
Well, not undiscovered, but, you know, if they keep in places like this, it'll be good. As long as they're in seated venues where you can't stage dive or anything in seated venues. As long as you stay in places like this, it'll be good, you know.
Well, it's a bit crowded, you know, but the music was good. The sound could have been a bit clearer, a bit louder, but, yeah, it was generally pretty good.
Have you seen them before?
No, I haven't, actually. Yeah. No.
It's really good, yeah. Yeah, second time I've seen them.
When was the first time?
Last year, about a year ago. Yeah. Just right on. The band. Yeah, they were wicked. Really enjoyed them. No, didn't see them last year, but they're really good. Oh yeah, top band. Yeah.
Called them possibly the most beautiful band in the world. Sara magazine called them a bunch of imbeciles. I'd say the answer lies somewhere in between. Certainly everyone who saw them at Rock City tonight seemed to have a good time. Nirvana are big already, but it looks as if they're going to be getting bigger, so watch out for them because they're going to be monstrous in the 90s.